Hello and welcome to Mr. Valentin's YouTube video for English 9 Regions. We're doing a poetry review today. Today we're going to be looking at a couple things. The first thing we're going to start with is a review of literary terms. What literary terms do we need to know that are important for our poetry unit? Then we're going to do some examples of said poetry literary terms. We'll move forward into identifying rhyme scheme, and we'll be going over how to identify meter. And then we'll be closing with the 8-step method of poetry. So let's begin. The first set of literary terms we're going to look at are figurative language literary terms: metaphor, simile, personification, and imagery. Figurative language is expressing ideas indirectly or language used in a special way to create a special effect. So now we need to be able to define said literary terms. So, first up, metaphor. A metaphor is comparing two unlike things without using the word like or as. The second that we're going to examine is simile, and that's simply a literary term that, or phrase that uses the like or as. So comparing two things with the word like or as. Personification is giving lifelike qualities to non-living or non-human things. Finally, we have imagery, which is descriptive language poets use to create words or word pictures or images. So those are the figurative language literary terms. The second literary terms that we need to know are sound devices. Sound devices are used in poetry to create musical quality. So, first up is rhythm, the pattern created by stressed and unstressed syllables, usually used in a sequence . Next we have rhyme, repetition of identical or similar sounds . Very important. We have alliteration, repetition of initial consonant sounds, We have assonance, repetition of vowel sounds in nearby words, and finally, we have onomatopoeia, which is the use of a word whose sound imitates its meaning. These are the final six literary terms you should know for your exam. These literary terms are the ones that don't comfortably fit into either figurative language or in sound devices. So they go into this other category. And these are often the literary terms that make up what is a poem. So after this, we're going to examine some examples and put them all together. So, first up is a euphemism. Euphemism is simply a nicer way of saying something. So instead of saying, he sweated all over the place, he perspired. A stanza is simply grouping of lines. Couplet. A couple, as in two, is a grouping of two lines. Quatrain is a grouping of four lines. Meter is a controlled pattern of rhythm. And finally, we have syllable, which is a unit of pronunciation. Each unit of pronunciation has one vowel sound that's produced. All right, so we'll just simply define it as a unit of pronunciation. Great. So now let's take a look at some examples and see if we can identify what literary terms we are seeing. Okay, so here we have various sentences, and each one of these sentences represents a different literary term. So the question becomes, what literary term do these represent? So hopefully you have a list of the literary terms written down. All right. Again, the important literary terms you need to know are alliteration, assonance, couplet, euphemism, imagery, metaphor, meter, onomatopoeia, personification, quatrain, rhyme, rhythm, simile, stanzas, and syllable. So, let's take a look at the first sentence. She is faster than a lightning bolt. I'm pausing there. Right? Immediately, what we notice is that there's a person, and this person is being compared to a lightning bolt. So we immediately notice it's a comparison. But there is a complete lack of the word like or as. So if we have a comparison that does not use like or as, what do we have? And of course, the answer is metaphor. The next line. He ran heaving heavy hearthstones. He ran heaving heavy hearthstones. So immediately we notice there's sound devices here, because there's sound being produced that's slightly unusual. And so what do we notice? We notice the H sound. He heaving heavy hearthstones. So we have, of course, alliteration. If you're saying, be quiet, instead of shut up, what are you doing? If you're saying, be quiet, instead of shut up, what are we doing? And of course, we're saying something nicer than shut up, which is not a nice thing. So of course, here we have euphemism. He jumped the gun and was running. He jumped the gun and was running. So, no one here is exactly being compared to anything, so we can knock out metaphor or simile. So, sound devices need to come into play. So, what are we hearing? He jumped the gun and was running. And so, what we begin to see, of course, is the sound. Jumped, gun, running. And so here we have assonance. The cat meowed. The cat meowed. So the word meow is what literary term? And of course, the answer is onomatopoeia. And finally, the dog is beautiful like a rose. The dog is beautiful like a rose. So we immediately see the word like, and we see that the dog is being compared to said rose. And so if we have a comparison that doesn't use like or that is using like or as, what do we have? And of course, the answer is simile. So these are the types of questions that you'll see on your exam that you'll have to identify the literary terms. The literary terms will be given for you, but you will have to identify which literary term is being used in that specific instance. The next thing we're going to go over is identifying rhyme scheme. Rhyme scheme is fairly easy to go over. So I'm going to do an example, and then what I'd like you to do in the second half is pause the video and then write down the rhyme scheme for the second part. So, we begin. Bid me to weep and I will weep while I have eyes to see, and having none and yet I will keep a heart to weep for thee. So when we identify a rhyme scheme, the first thing we do is start with the first letter of the alphabet. So we look at the final word, weep, see, keep, and thee. So, weep is the first word, so it always gets the first letter, which is A. C. Does the word see rhyme with the word weep? If the answer is no, then we move on to the next letter of the alphabet. And so we do. B. Keep. Does keep rhyme with see? No. But does it rhyme with weep? Yes. So it gets the same letter. Finally, the. All right, the doesn't rhyme with keep, but it certainly rhymes with C. So our rhyme scheme, if we were to write it out, would be A, B, A, B. So what I'd like you to do now is pause and write down the rhyme scheme for the following poem by Robert Frost. Hopefully you went and paused the video, and so now the rhyme scheme. So again, night, first letter of the alphabet, So we're giving it the letter A. Rain does not rhyme with night, so we give it the letter B. Light rhymes with night, so we give it the letter A. Lane rhymes with rain. Beat does not rhyme with any of the aforementioned letters, so we give it the letter C. Explain rhymes with lane, so we give it the letter B. Feet rhymes with beat, the letter C. Cry does not rhyme with any of the other letters, so it gets a new one. It's the letter D. And street rhymes with feet and beat, so it gets the letter C. So at the end, your rhyme scheme is ABA, BCB, CDC. And that's rhyme scheme. The second to last thing we're going to go over is identifying meter. Now, if you're watching this as an outsider, for thy ninth graders, I taught them a very basic meter, which is just reading everything as iambic. So, while there are other meters, because they are ninth grade, and appropriate for their level, I stuck with simply reading everything as iambic meter. So, let's look at some examples. So when we're identifying meter, we need to be able to count syllables. So, the first one, Milton Mallard mailed a mangled mango. Milton has two syllables. We always start with the U. Milton. Mallard, how many syllables? Mallard, two. Mailed, how many syllables is mailed? One. A. Mangled, two. Mango, mango. Then, we want to break in each of these by two, all right? So at the end of each slash, you should have a line. And then we count those numbers. One, two, three, four, five. And so this sentence is pentameter. If you have a second, I would pause the video and write down these and try to identify the rhyme scheme, or the meter, shall I say. The dog went rough. The dog went rough. So, the dog went rough. We separate it. We have two. So this is an example of Demeter. She picked perfect pickles. She picked perfect pickles. She picked perfect pickles. We separate. And so we have trimeter. And the last one, on a proud round cloud in a white high night. We separate. Two, three, four, five. So we have pentameter again. So after identifying all that, I would love to take a look at these and identify what other literary terms we see going on in these sentences. So taking a look at the first one, Milton Mallard mailed a mangled mango. What literary term do we see there, more pronounced than the other ones? And of course, we hear that M sound. So of course we have some alliteration. But we should also take note, mailed, ailed, mango, ango, all right, mango. All right, so the AN sound is producing some assonance. In the second sentence, the dog went rough. If a dog went rough, we know we have onomatopoeia. She picked perfect pickles. She picked perfect pickles. Again, the P sound is clear, and so we have alliteration. And finally, on a proud round cloud in a white high night. All right, that proud round cloud, that ow sound in each of them, all right, and even in high night, is producing assonance. The final part is the 8-step method on how to analyze a poem. This is what we've been doing with our presentations. This is how we've been looking at poems. So, what's important is that you have them memorized, because this is exactly what the test is going to show. 10 blanks, so they're each worth 2 points, and you have to fill in the blank. There's no word bank, there's nothing there to help you, so you just have to instinctively know. So the first one is, what does the title tell us? The second is, who is the speaker? The third is, who is the imagined reader? The fourth is, what is the tone? The fifth is, what is the situation? The sixth is, what is the speaker's attitude towards the situation? The seventh is, what is the theme? And the last one is, how does the use of literary techniques or literary themes or literary terms suggest, develop, or reinforce the theme? All right. A little helpful hint for you guys. All right. Titles, first we always begin, when we're reading a poem, we start with the title. Once we're done, we have to think of who's the speaker, all right? And it's never the author, who's the speaker, and who is the speaker speaking to? It's the imagined reader, the imagined audience, all right? The tone is just one you're going to have to remember. Situation, this I can help you with. Notice in number 6, we have the word situation, so the answer to 5 is situation. 6 situation, so 5 situation. So what is the speaker's attitude towards the situation? Number 6. What is the theme? And like, in number 6, all right, where it is the answer to 5. In number 8, we have the answer to number 7. All right, so look at 6 for the answer to 5. Look at the 8 to remember the answer to 7. So now what we're going to do, now that we've gone through everything, is we're going to take a look at one last poem, and we're going to go through each of the 8 steps. So we have the poem Sister Cat by Frances Mays. We're going to go read the poem, and then what I'd like you to do is pause it and try to write down what 8 things you would find using the 8-step method. So let's read the poem together. Cat stands at the fridge, cries loudly for milk. But I've filled her bowl, wild cat, I say. Sister, look, you have milk. I clink my fingernail against the rim. Milk with down and liver. A word I know she hears, her sad meow. She runs to me. She dips in her whiskers, but doesn't drink. As sometimes I want the light on when it is on. When I saw the woman walking toward my house, and I thought, there's Frances. Then look in the car mirror to be sure. She stalks the room. She wants milk beyond milk. World beyond this one, she cries. So the first thing we want to do, of course, is identify the title, right, which is Sister Cat. When you hear a cat being related to a sister, right, what are some things that might tell us? It might tell us that the cat is someone very close to this person, right? That this person deeply cares for their cat. So the speaker, often in class we've been hearing it's the narrator, which isn't very specific. Right? Take a look at the poem line by line and try to figure out who could be the speaker. Cat stands at the fridge, cries loudly for milk, but I've filled her bowl. Wild cat, I say, sister, look, you have milk. I clink my fingernail against the rim. So who could be this person that's speaking? And of course, it's the owner of the cat, all right, or someone who deeply cares for this cat. All right, I would say owner. So who's the imagined reader? And the imagined reader could be the cat itself. The imagined reader could be an onlooker watching the cat. The tone. You have to go through and kind of examine what things might bring out the tone. And I think you can examine this poem either which way, but I think there's a couple words that clue us in on how this person is feeling, or this cat is feeling. So it says, wild cat, I say, sister, look, you have milk. I clink my fingernail against the rim. All right. With down and liver, a word I know she hears, her sad meow. All right. The word sad is the first time that it's kind of, maybe this is a distressing poem. All right. She dips in her whiskers, but she doesn't drink. If someone's not drinking, again, there must be something wrong. The cat is upset. As sometimes I want the light on when it is on, when you desire something. So the poem, which might seem kind of jovial about a cat, right, suddenly becomes this kind of sad and distressing poem. Words like stalks and ending with the word cries are clues that the tone is rather sad. And of course, the question is, why is the cat sad? And this is where we start to explore the situation. All right, she's not drinking her milk. All right, what is the message? All right, that there's a world beyond this one that she wants, she desires something more. And that's not just the cat, it's also the owner. What's the speaker's attitude towards the situation? She sympathizes with this cat, right? She understands this cat, that this cat longs for something greater than what she sees. All right, themes, All right. The world beyond. Desire. All right. Wanting more. All right. Needing more. Those are the kind of, you know, that's a very blatant theme, all right? But you could say distress. All right. And she cries loudly for the milk. Finally, how does the use of literary techniques suggest, develop, or reinforce the theme? You have a lot of literary terms. Right. Notice the word clink. Notice the word meow. So we have onomatopoeia. And in this poem, onomatopoeia kind of helps us really see the cat and understand the cat. The cat and the woman are very similar. So the cat is taking on human characteristics. So the poem, by examining it, right, things like her sad meow, the fact that she's crying, she's given these very human characteristics. So personification helps develop the theme of the poem, which is wanting more. So that's how you examine a poem using the 8-step method, going through and examining. So on your test, you'll be given a poem you've never seen before, and it's a very simple poem, but it's very much in the same vein as this, where you'll have to go through and really think about, what are the 8 things that I'm seeing? So that brings us to the end of the YouTube video. If you have questions, please feel free to contact me. Right. Watch the video again. Remind yourself, what are the literary terms? What is the 8-step method? All right. The rhyme scheme and the meter are stuff that we already have ingrained in our heads, so we should already know these things. All right. It's this other stuff, the remembering the literary terms and analyzing the poem, that have proven more difficult than simply what's the meter, what's the rhyme scheme. That's been very easy for us. So keep in mind with that. All right. On my website, of course, is the Prezi, which goes through all of the literary terms as well, in case you need other reinforcement. Right. If you need to download any of the handouts, by all means, please visit my website at dvalentin.pbworks.com. And if you're an onlooker and you have any questions about what I do, all right, you can email me at amhs.academy@gmail.com. Thanks for listening, and I wish you best of luck on your poetry exam or your understanding of poetry.